we've gotten into this movie, and like, it's a really cool girl, yeah. Like, it's somebody like, you want to become, don't turn red on me, we're talking right now. Don't worry about these people around. It's like this cool chick, right? And like, there's people following her around, like she's cool, right? Or you see a guy, and you're like, man, I want to kind of be that guy. And these movies, do they not have a way of wrapping our emotions? Like, we become the character, right? Like, the first time I saw Iron Man, I was Iron Man. I was picking my kids up in the living room, throwing them around. I mean, it was amazing. I was making the sound. Little kids, when they see Spider-Man, do they not go around? You ever seen that? Have you ever been so emotionally involved in a movie, and then what happens? The credits roll, the movie is out, and then you have to return back to what, who you are, right? And like, there's this little sinking feeling, and you're like, man, I was it for a minute, right, Aaliyah? I was it. And then, now I'm just Matthew. So it's back to reality. Well, tonight, wouldn't it be cool if God could do something in your life that totally transforms you, that it impacts you for not only this lifetime, but for the one to come in all of eternity? Tonight, the title of this message is, The Cross is a Choice. How many of you guys are thankful for the cross? Is that not something that we were thankful for? We're getting ready for Easter Sunday, and I don't know how much Kara talked about it, but Easter Sunday, for you guys that aren't familiar with it, it's Resurrection Sunday. This is like if the Super Bowl has like 100 million viewers on Super Bowl Sunday night, this is like the Mecca times 10 of how many people are going to flood into the churches to hear about a Savior that was killed and crucified and broken on a cross, and 3 days later he rose from the dead. Now, Hollywood can't recreate something like that because this actually happened, and it was a gift to humanity. How many of you guys are going to be here Sunday, Easter Sunday, 16th? Okay? Beg, borrow, or steal a vehicle to get here. If you have to. But don't steal it. Just call me and Cindy, and one of us will pick you up. The other thing is invite a friend. How many of you guys know how easy it is to get somebody to come to church on Easter Sunday? It is the easiest Sunday to get somebody to come to, because that's like the cool thing to do, is go to church. Chances are they will come. Everybody stand up. Look at your neighbor. Look at your other neighbor, the one you didn't choose the first time, and say, for the next 14 minutes and 30 seconds, do not talk to me because I'm after someone. Once again, the title is, The Cross is a Choice. How many of you guys are glad that Jesus chose to hang himself upon that cross? We, in turn, are going to have to make a choice. Here we go, John chapter 5. Who's excited to be here? Is that everybody? I'm starting to pump up off this. John chapter 5, this is what it says. Did anybody read their Bible this week? Anybody got fed? Have they fed their soul this week? A few hands? Okay, well, we're going to get knee-deep in it right now. Here it says, John chapter 5. Last week we talked about a woman that most people would overlook, but not Jesus. He went out of his way to find this woman and love on her and save her soul. This week, he goes out of his way to find a group of people, a crowd of people that most people would want to not only look past, but step over and go the opposite way or move to the other side of the road. Why? Because they were broken and they were hurting, but we serve a God who seeks those people out. Jesus had a ministry of 3 years. I don't know if you guys realize that. Jesus only performed miracles, signs, and wonders for 3 years. He lived to be 33, is what most scholars say. But 3 years he did ministry for. I've been a youth pastor now for almost 3 years here. Before that, I drove buses and stuff like that. But 3 years is a short amount of time, isn't it? And some of you guys have been here for longer than 3 years, and I've watched you grow. But here's the thing about this. If there is a scripture in the Bible that Jesus has a conversation with or encounters twice in the Word of God, it's important, right? So if he has an encounter with the same person two times, and he only has 3 years to train these 12 disciples to spread the gospel so that me and you here 2,000 years later in the United States, that's safe to say that this is an important demonstration of God's love, right? Here we go. John chapter 5. The book of John. It says this. It says, afterwards, Jesus returned to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish holy days. Inside the city, near the sheep gate, was the pool of Bethesda, with 5 covered porches. Crowds of sick people, blind, lame, or paralyzed, lay on the porches. So, I looked up on Google, you can look up anything on Google, and they had excavated where this particular place was located. I mean, they found it, right? They've got the pools, they've got the covered porches, they've got the whole deal, and it's going on, and they know that this thing exists, and what this was a crowd, much larger than the crowd here tonight. This is a good crowd, but this is a big crowd. And they were surrounded by the pool. But what made this crowd unique is every person in that congregation of people needed something. They all needed to be changed. Why? Because some couldn't walk. Cassie, they couldn't walk. Me and you, we can walk. And if we can't walk, guess what? We can go to the doctors and they'll give us a wheelchair. And we'll get to put a sticker in our car and we get to park in front of everybody. And not a bad rap. These people could not walk. They did not have wheelchairs. And it was a horrific situation. And this is where it gets unique. Out of the crowd of people, Jesus found, he may have talked to several people, but the recording says he talked to one. And this is what the conversation that he had. This is the same man that he meets twice in his 3 years of ministry. It says, when Jesus, let me get back to where I'm at here. It says, one of the men lying there had been sick for 38 years. When Jesus saw him, look at your neighbor and say, 38 years is old.
38 years is young.
I mean, I was sick for 3 months and I thought, this ain't good. Lord, take me now. This has just been 3 weeks. He had been sick, unable to walk for 38 years. Stay with me. When Jesus saw him, he knew he had been ill for a long time. I spent some time in South America on a mission trip at one point in my life. And there was a young man that he didn't have any legs. His legs were kind of like nubs. Have you seen somewhere where they've been amputated? A lot of parts of the world, they have no health care at all, none. They don't have wheelchairs. They're lucky if they can make crutches out of something. It's not a good deal. And this man, there is nothing more inhumane than seeing somebody with nubs trying to walk around, right? Because if you don't have a wheelchair, the only way that you can get around, this guy was using his hands. And his hands, can you imagine how callous his hands would have been? I mean, it was tough to look at. It was heart-wrenching. Sometimes, in this picture, we don't know if this man wasn't just kind of crawling on his belly kind of to get where he's going. We don't know. We know that he couldn't walk. And Jesus looks upon this man that was in desperate need. And he asks him a really, really important question, right? What do you think you would ask a man if you were Jesus if you've been sick for 38 years? What do you think you would say? Dawson, what would you say? If you were Jesus, you saw somebody, he's paralyzed, what do you think you'd say? He'd say, how'd you lose your leg? No, Jesus, he went off that. That's a good point. He says, would you like to get well? Right? Would you like to get well? So here's the scenario. It's 2017 now. This is a crowd of people here, and the similarities between this crowd and the crowd that Jesus was in that night are very similar. Why? Because there's not one person here that is not in a need, in almost a desperate state of needing to be changed. There's not one person here. You can be the best looking, funniest, most talented person. You could have woke up this morning and your hair parted itself. You didn't even comb it. It parted itself. Parker, that's what I'm talking about. You could have got up and your mom was like, hey, I got you some new cowboy boots, baby. I want you to try them on. You try them on. And she's like, oh, by the way, Dad's going to give you that truck that he just bought. Like, it's looking like a good day, right? And you get to school, and all the ladies and all the gentlemen, depending on who you are looking at you, whether you're male or female. It is looking like a good day. And then you get home. And then the new wears off. The truck breaks down. the hair falls out. You know what I'm saying? Like that. Oh. Now here's the deal. This is where it gets important. You start to realize, man, I'm in need of something that's going to last. I'm in need of something that's going to change, because the truck and the girls and the cars, and they don't last. So I need something that's significant. He says, would you like to get well? And I thought to myself, man, only Jesus can get away with that kind of question. I've been lame for 38 years, but he doesn't know who Jesus is at this point, because he's just a man to him. He hasn't been revealed yet in the crowd of people. Remember, he just revealed himself to the Samaritan lady for the first time. So here it goes. He says, would you like to get well? And if I was that guy, and I'd been sitting there for 38 years, I'd said, you bet. You bet. I don't know your name, but I want to call you out right now. You bet. I'm ready. I want to get healed. I've been here for 38 years. I'm not even 38 years old. So he's been sitting there from the time my mom was pregnant until now. That's a long time. And this is what he says. He says, I can't, sir. You want to be healed? I can't, sir. He says, the sick man said, for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles. And this is interesting, because I had done some research on this. The pool of Bethesda was known that once a year an angel would touch the water and it would bubble and there would be a stirring. And whoever was first into the water would get healed. So perhaps this man saw people get healed, right? So now we're in this crowd to bring this to 2017. You're sitting here and you're thinking, man, I have been here Wednesday night after Wednesday night after Wednesday night, and I have seen the person to the left or the person to the right of me get a touch from God, but it has never been me. Well, tonight is the night for you. And he's searching through the crowd, and he's looking into your souls, and he's beginning to prepare your hearts right now. So this is what I want us to do. We're going to get into the scripture, but this is what God is asking me to do tonight. Whatever in your life that has hindered you from following Christ or going after Christ, and there's a list of things. There's relationships, there's drugs, there's alcohol, there is what we put into our ears when we listen, what we expose our eyes to, computer screens, pornography. There's all these different things. There's excuses. There's just a long line of things, but everybody's different. But whatever has been keeping you from receiving what God has in store for you, begin to ask the Holy Spirit to reveal that. Sometimes we don't even know. We don't even know until the opportunity arises. Because what did this man say? Do you want to be healed? He was like, well, I can't. I can't because I have no one here to help me. And some of you guys are saying, Jesus is saying to you, do you want to be changed? Do you want your life to be changed? Or do you want to end back up here in the same seat next Wednesday night in the same old nature, the old sinful nature, the old step? And you're saying, I went down to the altar last Wednesday, but nothing happened. I don't want that for anybody. That's why when I pray, don't let anybody leave here the same way they came in. Because there's one thing about God. When he comes up to you and says, do you want to change your life completely? It's easy. He was the only person in the world that could have came up to that man and said, well, dude, do you want to get well? That's all it took. Do you want to get well? Why can he make that claim? Because he's God's son. Why can he make that claim? Because he chose the cross. Why can he make that claim? Because he's the life giver, the life restorer, and the life redeemer. That's who he is. Instantly, the man was healed. That's a shocker, right? Instantly, the man was healed. You know what complicates things? We're in this New Life group here. We're a community of believers, students. This is a large percentage of the community here, the middle school here. And we look around week after week and we think, man, why didn't I get a touch from the Lord? Let's go ahead and start to roll that video. This evangelist is awesome. This was representation of camp last year. Let's listen.
Imagine to your disbelief if she clicked some buttons on her on that cash register, and all of a sudden she opens it up, she takes your $20 bill. Maybe it's a little bit torn, maybe it's a little bit dirty. And she takes your $20 bill, she reaches into that cash register, and she grabs a brand new $20 bill. And she hands it to you and says, there's your change. I've seen a whole lot of kids get up, and all they are is a new $20 bill. It's not the real change that they needed. It wasn't that God didn't change them. It just simply, you didn't allow him to change. change you the way that he wants to change you, it means that he's going to have to break some things. It means he's going to have to destroy some things in your life. He's going to have to tear some things. He's going to have to ruin some things in your life.
Did you catch that? Did you catch what he said? You see how many teenagers are down there? You know how many of them actually were changed when they came back to their seat? Only God knows, right? Only that individual knows. You know how many people comes to these altars every Wednesday night? You know how many of them, the percentage that comes back to their seats unchanged? I don't know, God does, right? But what he laid upon my heart was this. It's not that he can't change you. It's not that he won't change you. It's not that he can't change you in an instant. It's that you're not allowing yourselves to be changed. Did you catch it? Thousands upon thousands of teenagers. He's probably talked to over 100,000 teenagers. Incredible evangelists. Why? Because we don't allow ourselves to get dirty, to get broken, to separate. There's going to be some separation. You know, for real change to happen, there has to be something broken. Do you realize that? And you know who was broken for us? His name is Jesus. He's already done the heavy lifting. He hung upon that cross and his body was broke. Matter of fact, Scripture says that he was unrecognizable. They said that the movie The Passion of the Christ, I don't know how many of you guys have saw it, they said that it would have been so gory to try to do justice to the scene upon the cross that they couldn't show it in the United States because it would have been X-rated because of violence. He was unrecognizable. That means disfigured. You wouldn't have known who he was. And as he stood up there and he took that beating, it was for an opportunity right now to be introduced to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm going to close with this because it's not about what I have to say. It's about what God wants to do. And we're going to leave a lot of time. I met a young man. It's a young man that I've known for years. I've watched him grow up. And I met him and I had an encounter with him. And God had led me to his path. And me and my wife, we talked about this young man for the last few years. I wonder what happened to so-and-so. I wonder where he's at. He was brought up in church. He knew about the Lord. He's had a rough life. His home life was not good, to say the least. And that's keeping it G-rated. It was not good. And I saw this young man in a parking lot a while back. And I sat down next to him, and I didn't recognize him because I couldn't recognize him. It had been a few years since I saw him, and he's grown up to a young man. And I didn't even know who he was. And I said, hey, God has asked me to come over here and talk to you. He was tugging on my heart, and God begins to speak to our spirit. And right now, I pray that God will begin to speak to your spirit about some things that need to be broken, some relationships that need to be severed and dismembered, just as he was broken and he was shattered. And this young man, he asked me a question. And I don't know if he was trying to change the subject. That's okay. But what he said was, I've asked a lot of pastors this question. Why can I feel God when I go into church, but yet when I go home or the next day, he seems to be nowhere around? And I thought about that. I didn't really have... That's a good question, right? We've all experienced those feelings. And I thought about that for a long time. And I thought, well... What we experience when we come to the altar sometimes is no more than an emotional high. And I'm not saying that God didn't give us these emotions to enjoy his spirit. He did. But that is not real change. You see, he has done everything that he needs to do for your life to have victory, joy, and peace. Notice I didn't say happiness. Because happiness is simply when good things are happening. Joy comes from the spirit, the knowledge of knowing God. It comes from his strength. And you can have joy when you're going back to a crappy home where your parents fight. You can have joy when your parents are getting divorced. You can have joy when everybody steps over you to avoid you. You can have joy. It's different than happiness. And that's because God has given it to us. Now here's the thing that we're going to do different tonight. I looked at that young man. And I thought to myself, my goodness, God, you have brought me to this young man. He grew up in this very church. You want me to witness to him? What can I say to him? What can I do to him? And he said, you know, Matthew, he said, I am in desperate need of a job. I need a job. He said, I've got kids. I've got all these things going on. I have no way to support him. And I said, God, I don't have a job for him. I can't hire him where I'm at. I don't have any money. He was still a teenager. I don't have anything I can do for him. And God provides a person to come in. and it's another guy that comes to the church. Immediately, his vehicle was behind me. And I said, hey, man, I said, can you get so-and-so a job? He said, absolutely, I can get him a job. If I give him a recommendation, I can get him a job. And so I went over, I said, like, this is awesome. You don't even know how pumped up I am right now, because God is providing the answer for what this person is wanting. He's wanting a change of life. He's wanting his life to be radically changed and fulfilled by God's authority and his love and because of what he's done upon the cross. And so I said, this is good. So I get the two guys together, and they're talking, and they're swapping numbers. And so a few days go by, I'm going to follow up with this young man. I want to know if he was willing to change and if he was willing to give up a few things to receive this gift from God, right? Because we're not going to be able to sit at home and wait for God to come to us. Sometimes we've got to get on our hands and knees and say, Lord, do you see me? I need a touch from you. I'm tired of being the same thing Wednesday night after Wednesday night and preaching the same message. I need a touch from you. So I follow up with the young man. The young man did not follow up with the guy who was going to get him a job, right? And so I think to myself, was he really willing to change? Or did he want something from God to be handed to him and he have no skin in the game? Which means he has no responsibility, no application, nothing to have to do with this opportunity that's before him. And this is what I want us to understand, and I'm closing right now. This is so very important. Remember I told you there was two encounters with this man, right? The first one was miraculous. The first encounter with this young man at the parking lot was miraculous. One, because he happened to be there when I was there. That's a miracle. I'm hardly ever in heaven. The second thing was that God had put him on my heart to go and witness to him. The third one was that there was another guy that pulled up right beside me to offer him a job. You see where I'm going with this, right? So this is what happened. This is the end of this story, and now we're going to close with this. Everybody ask the Lord one more time, reveal something to me. Just speak this in your spirit. Lord Jesus, reveal something to each student that is keeping them from changing, keeping them from growing, keeping them from your glory and your blessing. Amen. This is the end of the story. Jesus evidently dismisses himself. He doesn't even know who it is. He didn't even know it's Jesus that healed him. Why? Because the first healing was in preparation for the second miracle. The first miracle was nothing compared to what he offered him next. Some of you guys can come in here and maybe you can receive a healing. Maybe you receive something that God touches you with. But if it doesn't last, then there's more to it. And this is what he said. He says, the man didn't know, for Jesus had disappeared into the crowd. He knew something had happened, because now he was walking. He hadn't walked in 38 years. But afterwards, Jesus found him in the temple and told him, now you are well, so stop sinning, or something even worse may happen to you. I can count on my hands how many times in the last 2 years that I have talked about sin. And the reason that I don't like doing it, and the reason that many people and many pastors don't like confronting sin, is because it's not comfortable. When I say stop sinning, you guys are thinking, okay, now there's judgment on me, now there's guilt on me. This isn't a good feeling. This was awkward. But Jesus thought it was powerful enough not only to heal this man's body, but to find him somewhere else in the community and track him now down and say, now the first gift was a miracle. But the second one will last forever. Stop sinning so you do not spend an eternity in hell. That's worse than not being able to walk, right? That probably trumps it. So here's the thing. Everybody stand up. This is what we're going to do now. We're going to close different. And I've left a lot of time, so I want to get this right. Whatever the Holy Spirit has anointed your mind with that is sin, that is separating you from receiving God's glory, what we're going to do, you're going to find a piece of tape below your chair. Go ahead and reach down for it. Pick up the piece of tape and strap somewhere to your chair. It's not an Easter egg hunt. It's right beside you. Pick it up. This piece of tape, we're not going to write on it because this is your business between you and God. To me, I don't care if it's pornography or foul language that you're into that's keeping you from being changed. But what I do care about is that tonight you don't come down to the altar and give your life to God and then go right back to that computer screen right after you leave the service. I don't care that you come down to the altar and say, Father, forgive me. You confess your sins, you believe in your heart, and you will be saved, and you will be saved, but not if you continue to go back to the old nature, because God says what I have made you is a new creation. And once you receive God's love and His forgiveness, I will not go back to that old self. Amen? Whatever this piece of tape symbolizes, it's sin. And that sin is going to get left right here along this altar. And what you're saying by that is, you're saying, you know what? I'm going to take this, and this is a barrier between me and God, and it's something that the old me dealt with, but the new me will not deal with, because God has broken the power of sin. And your homework next week is to read Romans 6. It talks about this entire thing in depth according to God's Word. Whatever this symbolizes to you, you're simply going to leave it right there. And you're going to invite God into your life. You're going to get things right with God. And when you leave it, you're leaving that sin there, and it will not be picked up.